So basically, I had a dream of spreading positivity around me, and that revolved around the fact that I'm being a feminist, like strongly believing in feminism, and then I wanted to change perceptions. And for a 16-year-old mind, by that time, no one actually sort of realized what I wanted to do. I mean, I thought that I would change perceptions, I'd change perceptions of this country, of the country's politicians, of the people, of women in general. But then, at that time, and even now, people think it's too far-fetched. People think I actually can't achieve it. So then, when you think about dreams, I mean, literally, we dream about a vacation in the Bahamas, or let's say, a really amazing roller coaster for me, or something of that sort, right? But going to more concrete levels, when we go on about, we come to a situation where we dream of a better life, a better future, a better job, better friends, stuff like that. But then again, it never goes to something concrete. And the reason is, a very big thing that is a very big stop sign for us is yes, but. Yes, but I'm still okay with what I'm doing. Yes, but I don't have enough money. Yes, that is my dream, but I don't have this, this, this. And that's the but which is stopping us from achieving our dreams. I had a lot of buts in my life. With that, I mean, when I used to tell someone, this is what I want to do. But Aisha, didn't you see what happened to Benazir? But Aisha, didn't you see what happened to people around you? But Aisha, don't you think it should, you know, we got an amazing grade in sciences, don't you think you should continue with that? And these are these buts that caught me into thinking that, you know what, I'm going to remove all these buts from my life. So these are stereotypes. And first let us think who creates these stereotypes. Do we want to become people who create these stereotypes, or do we want to become people who negate these stereotypes? I want to become a person who negates those stereotypes. For me, there's a lot of stereotypical nature in people around me. Coming from a family that was very conventional sort of believing, who did not actually believe in sort of me achieving to the path of what I'm achieving right now, is killing all these stereotypes. And to be very honest, stereotypes are meant to be killed. The reason we call them stereotypes, the reason in the world today there's a negative connotation attached to the word stereotypes, is because it's meant for us to kill them. Okay, moving on. Okay, so basically what I did for myself is the back from the future approach. So imagine you're a person 5 years from now, you have all the money in the world, you have all the resources in the world, you have all the abilities you wish to have, what would you see yourself doing? And that is how you see what your dream is. 5 years from now, the place you see yourself at, the stuff you're doing, the people around you, that is exactly what your dream is. So you have everything at your disposal, and then stop. And then you realize that situation where you have right now. Okay, so 5 years from now, I saw myself as a CEO of XYZ company. Right now, I'm just a student doing sciences, okay? From here to there, what is my path to take? And that is the back from the future approach. You decide what your path is, you decide where you want to stand 5 years from now, and then you go back slowly and gradually, reaching the point where you are now. That back from the future approach is kind of complex. First, it sort of reflects on changing your dream to your aim. And for me, there's something that inspired me, something that's very close to my heart, that there's one major difference between a dream and an aim. A dream is soundless sleep, and an aim is sleepless nights. For me, for example, when it came about changing perception, I was working with this NGO. We visited Thar, and upon our visit, there was a kid who was not actually wearing clothes. He was running around, and he's like, his son is an orphan. There is no one to take care of him. He's only 2.5 years old, and his mother died because she had nothing to eat.
First one is let go. Let go of everything else. It's your dream. It's basically something that you've created for yourself. If someone says don't rock that boat, you need to rock that boat because you need to prove them wrong. Second is your dream. That means you know what you're doing. You're the crafter. Technically, whatever you're doing, it's upon you. It's your experience. It's something you create for yourself. So if someone else says they give you recommendations or anything of that sort, if you don't, your mind does not comply with what everyone else is saying, leave that behind. Third one is connect back. Your dream needs to connect back to your passion. If you're afraid of your dream, if you're afraid of achieving your dream, that's something that clicks. For example, if someone's afraid of scoring bad in a test, that's because he cares about that test. If someone's afraid of walking up to a stage or has stage fright, that's because he cares about his image when he's walking up. Similarly, because you're afraid of your dream is because you need to be that determined to achieve it. Moving on to dreaming big. Someone who's told me the sky is the limit, I mean, it's very cliche. If the sky was the limit, why would there be footprints on the moon? I mean, technically, if someone tells you that something's the limit, you need to ask them to stop, and you need to make them realize that you create your own limits. In this world today, with technology, with everything advancing so much, when let's revert back to 50 years, would we stand in the place we are right now if we thought that, okay, something was the limit? To you, to everyone else, to me, nothing was the limit. And you need to create your own limits. And to be very honest, the word limit itself is very restricting. So just leave that aside and go on what you want to achieve. The last thing is being a movie star. Okay, so being a movie star is a dream, is a movie. For me, my dream was a movie. I just quote an incident. I went to this conference in New York last summer. It was my first day being very short. I was sitting at the corner. This guy, this black, he was, sorry if English says he was dark. He came to me and he asked me, he's like, where are you from? I was like, I'm from Pakistan. He's like, what are you doing here? Your country's at war. That guy was from Tin Islands. He was from an African country. He said, your country's at war. I was taken aback. I was like, people don't want value me. I have 1 month to spend here. I'm all alone. It's going to go really bad. 2 days from then, we were sitting in a room. People were passing anonymous chits. Actually, it was a session where you confess something. So in a room of 30, there were people from around 20 different countries. There was a chit we opened, like there was a terrorist in the room. Consciously or unconsciously, because I was the only Muslim in that room, people looked at me, technically. And that day, I thought that I wouldn't manage. I thought that, you know, and I sort of need to step back. I cannot achieve this. I mean, I came here to make a mark. I came here to prove myself, but technically, I have no one's support. And in that conference, basically, everything was about the votes you were supposed to get. Everything was about consensus. It was a leadership summit. So moving on from that day, but then I realized if my dream is about changing perceptions, this has got to be the trailer. And I worked and worked to make that the trailer. And to be very honest, it wasn't as easy as I had expected it to. There were days when I didn't sleep. There were times when I researched all night. There were times when I woke up at 3 a.m. when my South African roommate was sleeping, and then all of that. But then at the end of the day, the same guy from the islands, after I gave given my speech, after I had become one of the 14 people out of 350 to be selected as the leadership council member, the guy came to me and was like, I'd want to come to Pakistan. And that's when I realized, you know what, I'm going after my dream, because my trailer was successful. A movie trailer has like a million likes on YouTube. That was my feeling that time. You know what, my trailer was successful, I'm going for my movie. Okay, so about daring to fail. I mean, it's very cliche, it's very paradoxical how I said that you dare to dream and then you dare to fail. Failing itself is a teacher in soul. That's something we've heard throughout, that's something our teachers have told us, and we just let it pass by. And to be very honest, failure is something that makes you learn. Failure is something that tells you how to set things right. For me, this one time, we were watching TV, there was a report about how water is contaminated in Kinja Lake. I'm from Karachi, I don't know if you all can relate. I was like, my dad was sitting beside me, I asked him if we can do something about it. He said, you can't do anything about it because, I mean, I'm not in government this time, and technically, there's nothing that can be done about that. I was like, I mean, people are dying, people have measles, there's like a lot going on. How can someone I'm that close to say that we can't do anything about it? I went on an engine for a protest. I expected a lot of people to show up. I mean, I'd seen TV, technically there's like so many people a lot of times whenever there's a protest. So I went with like 12 people in front of the Karachi Press Club. We managed to get a couple of TV channels show up there as well. And when I went, I stood there for half an hour, no one showed up. So there, 1 hour, no one showed up. The TV channel began to pack, they went past by, and I was still standing there because I did not know what to do. I mean, I had failed, I had wanted to do something, I had wanted to negate a stereotype, I had wanted to negate a belief, but I was standing there. Then that was when I realized I had failed. And most of all that, I didn't realize someone took a picture of me holding a banner. 2 days from then, during those 2 days, that picture had gone some kind of viral, like 300 likes on Facebook. For me, that was viral. So I got a call. It was from an unknown number, international number. Said, are you Aisha Aleem? I was like, yes. They asked me, okay, you had a protest. It was about water. Could you tell us details of that? I was surprised that no one was speaking, but I told them details of that. It was an international NGO which wanted to help us, and they had seen it over social media. In Ibrahim Hedvi, a region outskirts of Karachi, they set up water treatment plants for the kids I wanted to do something for. So technically, when I'm trying to stay there, although I thought I had failed, although I thought I was trotted down, people said I couldn't do it. I mean, when I came back from the protest, my dad gave me that, told you so, look, that, you know, what I told you wouldn't work out. at the end of the day, I did manage to help people. Although the means justified the end, because that's what I wanted to achieve by the end of it. So, something that caught my eye is that, okay, one thing you know, the worst thing you would do to your dream, once you realize what your dream is that you let go of it. You should never let go of it. That's something you should keep on holding yourself. I mean, okay, it happened, the faith, the belief, for all those who believe in God, for all those who believe in themselves, it's something that you need to hold close to yourself. For example, the life itself, I see the world as a rat race. It's a bunch of rats running around for something. I mean, you could be a part of the rat race and win, but you would not feel as good if you were the Tom for the Jerry. But technically, I don't want to be one of those rats running behind for that cup at the end. I want to be the Tom for the Jerry who the rats are running away from. So technically, for me, that is how I approach my dream. That is how I see my dream. And last thing is starting now. By starting now, I mean a lot of people don't have dreams. A lot of people just go with the flow. And going with the flow is something that I just don't get. I mean, you're an individual. There's no one like you. You have an idea. You should not be going with the flow. You should be changing the flow. You should be the one being the turn for the flow. So it's not stupid to take a writing pad, write what you want, think of it, go 5 years from now. I mean, coming from a 17-year-old standing in front of you would be, okay, what is she saying? She doesn't know about life. But technically, trust me, to be very honest, now that I know what I want to achieve, there are nights when I don't sleep. There's so much I get involved to being CEO of an NGO, then running another, teaching students, teaching orphans, all of that. I don't get time for other stuff that people usually my age do. But at the end of the day, the satisfaction I get because I'm going nearer and nearer to my dream each and every passing day is something that cannot be replaced by anything else. So that's about it from my side. Thank you so much for listening.